Every generation has different characteristics. They have different motivators, preferences, and ways of engaging with companies. Now, learning about these is vital for organizations to remain relevant for the future. This is especially the case for not-for-profits and charities who rely on donors and supporters to continue to do great work in our communities. Our latest report that we've released is all about the not-for-profit sector and about understanding the different generations of donors. It looks to the future by analysing each generation and revealing insights about what motivates them to engage. So joining me today to discuss the insights from this report all about understanding each generation and their giving profile and behaviour and preferences is McCrindle's Managing Director and main author of this report, Sophie Renton. Hello, Sophie Renton.
Hello, Ash. Always a delight to be with you.
You always drop a lot of wisdom and a lot of gold on this podcast. I'm very excited to have you on. Now, I imagine if we've got some loyal listeners to this podcast, they would know that you are instrumental in authoring a lot of our internally driven reports around, you know, the future of the education sector, the future of the not-for-profit sector, all the different kind of big set pieces that we conduct each year. I wondered if you could elaborate on how we decide the themes to explore in each report, because I feel like obviously we know this, but our listeners probably aren't privy. So I thought we'd maybe open the lid a little bit. How do our team go about deciding on a theme for each of these sort of big sector-wide reports that we run?
Yeah, well, I think the first place we start is collaboratively. We get the team to give input into what they're seeing in the sector. Even the feedback from some of our clients, we are going out and presenting a lot. And as part of our briefing documents, we get notes from them to say what are the biggest challenges they're facing in their sector. We review some of that. We just take a step back and look at what do we see going on in the sector, and what questions are people asking that if we could find some answers to would really help them shift their organizations forward. And that's probably the start of the thinking. And then we dig deeper and we refine it more and more and more. And because we found that as we dig into one topic in a deeper way, we can actually provide better insights than touching on a whole range of topics, but not with enough color or enough substance to really guide decisions. So that's a little bit of the under the lid of how we do it here at McCrindle, but it is one of my favorite parts of my role, although I feel like I say that about leading the team as well. So I have multiple favorites, but being able to dig into the insights is a really enjoyable part of it.
Yeah, it's a big sign. We've always said it's always helpful for those of us in leadership roles to remain on the tools and to conduct research. And you have been in your previous role here, you know, research director, so played a big role in that. And yeah, it's great to see you've got an amazing research mind as well as a great communication set of skills to be able to communicate that. But yeah, I always love, you know, in the months before we release, obviously, the research, we have a big, like, almost concept meeting, and it's a few brains trust, you know, in the room to collaborate, like you said, and to gather each of us what we're seeing in the sector as we're out and about speaking or working with clients on research, and what are the pain points and what's relevant and what are the trends, and then getting to like delve deeper. And we always say research is almost like a confirming of your hypothesis on a bunch of things, so it's always good. And I think it was your idea, Soph, a couple of years ago, maybe it was the Future Consumer Report around you know, doing an expose into each generation, because we're often known in the world at McCrindle for our generational expertise. So we've kind of done that specifically in this report for the not-for-profit sector, although I believe, and that's why we're talking about it on the podcast today, that this has relevance for lots of organizations, regardless of whether we're talking to people who volunteer or engage with not-for-profits in whatever way. But in line or additionally to what we've just spoken about, so why do you think it is important for, well, let's say NFPs and charities, but also every organization to have an understanding of future donors for, you know, charities, but also just future consumers in general?
Understanding who the people are that you're trying to serve is absolutely imperative so that you can serve them to the best of your ability, whether that is a donor, whether that's a client, whether that's a customer. Understanding what motivates them, what drives them, what are their blockers, what are they looking for. If you can understand that and tailor your communication, tailor the insights that you're giving so it answers the questions that they're actually asking, and if you can provide ways of engaging that is what they enjoy and what they're looking for, you are bound to, I guess, deliver superior outcomes and to drive engagement with your organization and your positioning better than others in the sector. And it's not a nice thing to maybe even say that the not-for-profit sector is competitive, but there are a number of charities in Australia, and there are definitely opportunities where those charities can partner together, that they can bring about those greater impacts and outcomes. But it's really important for any organization, whatever sector you're in, to understand the people that you're trying to reach so that you can do that to the best of your ability, which is why we're talking about that today.
Yeah, and I think I was sharing about this recently as well with somebody, that every time we conduct a study on whatever topic, we always break it down by generation. And it's normally, almost always, fascinating to see the differences. Mm-hmm. That's a key kind of segment. We can segment by, you know, location. We can look at how people in New South Wales compare to Queenslanders, for example, or location. We can segment by gender. We can go really granular and segment by wealth and income quintile if we've got enough information on that. But the generations is just one that always yields almost the always most fascinating insights. Would you agree? I mean, you're doing a lot of these, what we call cross tabs or segmentation all the time. Is that the place, you know, the first place you go? It's the first place I go.
Yeah, I always start with the generations. I find them fascinating. And I think they're so interesting because everyone can resonate with the generational lens. All, as you're reading the report, you can go, oh yeah, that fits with me. Or like, oh no, I'm a bridge. I'm a millennial. I'm on that cusp between the Gen Z and the millennial. I can connect with both sides of them. It's that real, I guess we're all a little bit self-absorbed in some ways, that we love to be able to see ourselves in the data, and the generational lens provides that. But I think it also, for organizations, gives a wide enough range of ages for people to be able to make some collective decisions about some generational cohorts, but is, I guess, granular enough that they can actually do something with it. Because if you had 20 different segments that you were trying to do, that can be really challenging. Whereas if you've got four key segments and you can go, actually, okay, where do they align? Where do they differ? What can I do broadly as a communication strategy? What do I need to tailor depending on which generation is in front of me? The generations is a really great lens to be able to do that, and definitely the most fascinating.
Yeah, it's always really, really interesting stuff. And it's stuff that people I find lean into for reasons, like you said, it's everyone can relate. Everyone belongs to a particular generation, their children, their parents, whatever context, you know, you're looking at it over through the people in your life. And it's always a little controversial, which makes it interesting. You're like, oh, I don't think that, even though I'm a part of Gen Y, whatever it might be. So it's very personal. It's very relatable, and it's very interesting stuff. So let's unpack each of these generations and some of the insights that we have gleaned about them. Thought we could begin with the wonderful baby boomers. Now, I've got our generational profile in front of me and our pop map infographic. So a few key stats about the boomers. They're born between the years of 1946 and 1964, which places them today between the age of 59 and 77. They have a population within Australia of 4.8 million. So they were formerly the largest generation, but we know according to the latest census, they've handed that baton over to the millennials or the Gen Ys. And they comprise about 16% of the workforce. So still a really amazing generation. We know actually from another infographic, there's infographics flying everywhere in this podcast, but another infographic that we've just released about wealth and income, that they're an incredible generation because they've worked very hard throughout their life. They comprise under a quarter of the population, but they own, I think, more than half the nation's private wealth. So they're really in those amazing, you know, beneficiary years of those years of hard work that they've accumulated. But Soph, what stood out to you about the baby boomers from what we gathered from this study particularly?
Yeah, the baby boomers are an incredible generation. I think sometimes we don't give them enough credit for all that they've done to really build this country, that a lot of the benefits that we get to enjoy today are actually from the hard work of what the baby boomers have done. And yes, you can argue that they've had a great time of peace globally following the unrest of the wars, and they've been in this time of economic prosperity, but they've also worked exceptionally hard. And I think when we look at baby boomers, that level of commitment, I think, is something that we see that they bring to their donations, but also that they just bring to life, that they're hardworking, committed. They are quite loyal, that once they're invested or stuck with a brand or an organization, that they will ride that wave through. And so when we look at that, particularly with people's philanthropic giving, we can see that they are the most likely to be committed givers. They're the most likely to be, yep, this is an organization that has a great reputation. I believe in it. I'm engaged with it. And reputation is actually more important to baby boomers. That sense of longevity and credibility that's been built over a number of years is a key motivator or driver for our baby boomer generation, because that trust is built. So they are our most committed givers. And they're also the ones that are most likely to, I guess, think about those that are right in front of them presenting an immediate need. They're wanting to solve problems quickly. They're wanting to see solutions quickly, I guess. And that's where they're driving that immediate need. Whereas some of the other generations, and I'm sure we'll dig into this a little bit further, but they're looking for more of solving the root cause of that rather than meeting that immediate need right in front of them. Yet our baby boomers are quite happy to be meeting that immediate need. And then lastly, is probably a key insight about them, is that they are a really big local focus for this generation, that national identity is a lot stronger in our older Australians than in our younger Australians. So they're very, they love the idea of supporting a local Australian organisation working locally within Australia. So those are a couple of insights on the baby boomer generation.
Yeah, so good. And I think, I mean, if we've got any younger listeners out there, perhaps when we hear the word baby boomer, we think okay boomer, which is, you know, we've talked about it before on the podcast. I think one of the first episodes we were kind of going through each generation, and it was really great to hear actually Mark share about some of the, you know, research-based insights rather than just the stereotypes. And actually, we have a lot to be grateful for to the baby boomers for, as the generations coming after them. But yeah, you're right. In terms of, you know, not for giving to not-for-profits and charities, they are stepping up. They are giving. They're a generation that are willing to serve and engage. It was interesting as well. I've got the infographic component open in front of me, and the top three causes they're most likely to support are medical and cancer research, followed by disaster response in Australia, and followed by children's charities. So again, I think that even that disaster response coming in with that maybe more of a local focus and wanting to support issues and causes that relate to their own backyard and to the nation of Australia, which is interesting. And also, we also delved into, I guess, some of the what's the right word? Maybe like ways of
communication strategies.
Exactly. Communication strategies, or ways that organizations, communicate with their donors or their supporters or their customers or consumers, if we're thinking outside the not-for-profit sector. So we asked this question: where do you go to stay up to date with the charities and not-for-profits that you're engaging with? And number one was emails, number two was a website, and number three was Facebook. So a bit of a mix there. Also, all of those being, obviously technology platforms. And so we're still talking about a very tech-savvy generation, even though they're kind of some of the furthest away from these transformative times in terms of, you know, happening in their formative years. These are technologies that have come, and we sometimes even say these generations are like digital migrants. They've had to migrate to using the technology, and even sometimes I feel like a digital migrant, even though I'm a millennial, because you're like, too. Okay, and another platform to learn about. Cool. Or the more
you're
even
way
the
out
metaverse.
To date, though. You're on TikTok. I have not delved there, but you're all across that one, so you're doing better than most.
Yeah, thanks, Soph. Appreciate that validation. But so they're definitely a generation to, I think say thank you to, and to continue, if you're an organisation, to continue to communicate to and value and thank and engage, because they're active and they're different to the other generations, as we're now going to see. Now, we're going to move down the generation scale, for lack of a better word, to, I feel like, perhaps your favorite generation, Soph. You are just got a passion for the Gen Xers.
I do. I feel for them. I feel like they're the forgotten generation within everybody. And, you know, we talk about the baby boomers, that they establish things, and then we just kind of skip over Gen X and we go, oh, the millennials. And you know, you've said this before of, oh, it was a great time when millennials referred to the young people, but we've really passed that and on to the Gen Zs now. And so it's like, we focus on Gen Z and baby boomers, and Gen Y and millennials get like a little bit of airtime, but Gen X just kind of gets skipped over in the middle. And I think some of that is because that when we're drawing out those insights, we're looking for where are those greatest points of difference, which is obviously the baby boomers to the Gen Ys, sorry, the Gen Zs, really those are accentuated there. Whereas your Gen Xs are a little bit more the middle of the road, and they kind of, they'll sway sometimes to the older segment and they'll sway sometimes to the younger segment. And so you could call it a bit vanilla in terms of the insights that maybe come there. But I think it's really important that we actually talk about them. And Gen Xs are those that they're opportunity givers. So they're more likely to give if they're presented or if they are shown an opportunity, and that the impact that that can have if they give, because they choose to respond to the greatest need that's before them. So if they are presented with that opportunity, they'll jump on it. And I think part of that comes to the life stage, because if we think about Gen X, they are that sandwich generation that are caring both up and down, that they've got children, but they've also got parents that are going into maybe aged care or coming to live with them. And so their time is so precious because they are squashed kind of on both sides. So I think when we think about engaging with Gen X, whether that's philanthropically or just at any type of consumer level, it's just making things as simple and as easy as possible and frictionless as possible for a really time poor generation. So if we maybe go through some of those ones that we looked at before, they are more likely to be opportunity givers than committed givers. They are more likely than baby boomers to look for solving that root cause. So they've got that longer term view in mind, and they're going, I don't just want to give you a handout for a day. I want to really solve the problem so it's fixed for generations to come. And interesting, they are pretty much almost 50-50 split between whether they have a global or a local focus. So they really are that, I kind of call them the bridging generation between that older and that younger generations coming through. So yeah, I love them. I think they're great. I think there's a lot to be thankful for Gen X. So many of our leaders are Gen X today, and they've really, I guess, bridged the gap of older to younger, and a lot of us are living in the beneficiaries of what they've done as well.
Yeah, they are an absolutely incredible generation, and sadly sometimes forgotten, maybe even in just the fun generations to talk about. Like the baby boomers have a descriptive name, and then even though we often talk about Gen Y, it's sometimes more media savvy to talk about the millennials, and it's just the boomers and the millennials like going at it, and Gen X are like, hey guys, we're here too. And so I think it's really important to think about them. They are, as we've mentioned, contributing. And I was just looking again at this infographic, and it's interesting to see the causes that each generation supports. And I was just looking across all four generations that we're going to talk about, and each generation has a different number one cause they're motivated, like that they kind of all reorder, but the top one is different for every generation. So as I mentioned before, the number one cause baby boomers are most likely or most motivated to support is medical and cancer research, but for Generation X it's animal welfare and wildlife support as number one, followed by medical and cancer research, and then children's charities at number three. And again, if we just think about what communication platforms they're wanting to engage with not-for-profits on or about, it's emails at number one, Facebook at number two, so a bit of a reorder there compared to the baby boomers, and website at number three. Now, I mentioned earlier that, you know, sometimes we think okay boomer about maybe stereotypes with the baby boomers. I was thinking about how do we think about Gen X, and I was actually thinking even with the boomers that sometimes we might think of the name Karen and the bad rap that all the Karens have received over the last few years. And that led me to actually recall an article that we wrote, which was a bit of fun, but also kind of got a lot of traction. And it was an article that said, in defense of the name Karen, because we do a little bit of like names analysis here, as you know, Soph. And I just wanted to read a part of this article because it's very validating for the Gen X and the baby boomer, just generation in general, but like through the lens of the name Karen and sometimes the stereotypes that we might hold. So it says, This is just a section of the article. It says, contrary to the stereotype, Karens are more likely to be Gen Xers than baby boomers. But whether they be boomers or Xers, our Karens, like their peers, the Jennifers and the Michelles, are part of the mainstay of Australian communities. They have raised more children, earned and been taxed more, and volunteered more hours in their lives than their younger millennial counterparts, like the Jessicas, the Sarahs and the Emilys, which are the names that dominated the 80s and the 90s. So to the Karens and the Sharons, Donnas, Nicoles and Lisas, who dominated the births in the 1960s and have been contributing to Australia ever since, we say thanks for your contribution, your key part in the Australian community and the good name you have made for yourself. So a shout out just in general to the Xers and the Boomers. You know, we see you, we validate you with some great research here. As well, despite some of those younger generational, you know, stereotypes that might exist.
Got to have a little bit of fun between the generations every now and then. But yeah, I love that we can actually recognise the great things that Gen X have done, and all the Karens, because they really did get a bad rap during that time. I know someone who even at that time changed her name on a coffee order to, you know, make it a little bit of a better experience.
Yeah, that is fair. All right, let's move to Gen Y, arguably the generation that we might have the most authority on because we both belong to Generation Y. And I didn't actually define Generation X, sorry, before, but Gen X, born 1965 to 1979. And now we're talking Gen Y, born 1980 to 1994, which places this generation in 2023 between 29 and 43. So the youngest of the Gen Ys are now in their final year of their 20s. So we're really talking about, you know, those in their 30s, those in their 40s, not just starting their careers, but actually having a little bit more income, wealth, you know, financial backing, movements in their careers. Sophie, what can you tell our listeners about Gen Y?
Gen Y, yes, this is the generation that we are a part of. And I was really proud of Gen Y, actually, in this study, that we found that Gen Y are those that are really highly engaged givers and they're looking for long-term change. Well, there's a whole section in this report, and I encourage you, if you are part of the not-for-profit sector, get the report. It gives a whole lot more insight into this. But we did a whole section on the power of an engaged giver, and an engaged giver being one that doesn't just give their money and leave, but one that actually engages with those emails, that looks for those opportunities to engage. And those are most likely to be a Gen Y in their family forming years. They've got young kids. They're often trying to instill some of those values into that next generation, and they're doing it together as a family. And I was really proud of our Gen Ys, that they're looking for those opportunities and ways that they can, I guess, give generously as a family. If we run through some of those stats about them, we're starting to see that shift, that they're more likely to be opportunity givers and even more so than our Gen Xs. So Gen X, 56% were opportunity givers who would give when they're presented with a need or an opportunity. And that goes up to 67 for our Gen Ys, and only 33% of them are committed givers, which I think is really important for, charities and not-for-profits to know that as we're getting younger, we are getting less committed to one particular organization. But I do really want to preface the point that that doesn't mean that these generations are any less generous. They are actually giving frequently. They're just giving to a range of different organizations who are doing great things. They're less likely to stick with an organization for 20 years and just go, why is the point of greatest need? Where is my income going to make the greatest difference? And that's who I'm going to engage with at this point in time. So this generation, our millennials, they are also looking to solve that root cause. And that's really jumped up to 74% looking to solve that root cause, while only 26% are looking to meet that immediate need. And once again, this is the start of the shift. So if you've really got to group the generations, you'd probably group baby boomers and Gen X with a bit more of a similar approach to engaging, and your Gen Zs and your Gen Ys in that kind of secondary group of, or way of engaging, where they're looking to solve the root cause. And that is exciting for charities, that we've got people that are going, actually, we're with you. We want to go big picture. We want to, as that phrase goes, teach the man to fish, not just give him a fish. We want to really look at how we can do that. The challenge for organizations, though, is that they are often working on significantly complex problems, not-for-profits and charities. That global poverty, like, that's not something that you're going to solve in 2 years. Otherwise, we would have already done that. And so while we're trying to get to that root cause, there are people that are still in immediate need. And it's how do we engage these younger donors on that journey that, yep, we're still working towards this big picture goal, but we really need to be meeting people where they're at and solving the needs along the way while we're still trying to reach that high level goal. And I think we can see this across or outside of the not-for-profit sector, the Gen Zs and the Gen Ys, they've got really big picture, big aspirations. They view themselves as global citizens and they want to solve the big problems. They're not quite content with just the status quo. So I think they bring that perspective into the way that they engage with not-for-profits as well. And as that global citizenship, they're increasingly global in their focus for the organizations that they are looking to support.
Yeah, it's a great rundown of them, or of us, rather, we should say. And again, we have a different top cause among the Gen Ys being children's charities as the number one cause they're motivated to support, followed by mental health and then animal welfare and wildlife support. And among the Gen Ys, again, I feel like we're now starting to see a bit more social media enter the mix of how they prefer to be communicated with. And also just interesting, we'll get to Gen Z in a sec, but even just how Gen Y and Gen Z differ on the platforms that they prefer. So number one among Gen Y is Facebook. Number two is emails, and number three is Instagram, which is, again, really fascinating. And we sometimes compare like Gen Y and Gen Z just on an anecdotal, level. And I feel like, you know, the Gen Ys are in the place of, you know, Instagram and a little bit of Facebook remnants. And then, you know, the younger generations are even like, oh, Instagram's old school now, you know. So it's interesting to see exactly how even those like nuances compare across the generations, which is great. So then we come to our, I guess, emerging / future donor of Generation Z, born between the years of 1995 and 2009, which means that the Gen Zs are aged today between 14 and 28, which I feel like is an interesting time at the moment, because you've got half the generation, or not half, but or let's just say half, like around 20 or under. So not all of them are teenagers, but a lot. And then you've got the other half like in their 20s, in their early years. But then the older Gen Zs might even be parents if they've had children young, even though we know people generally are pushing back that. So it's interesting, they're in like a real transition kind of life stage where we've still got like the youngest Gen Z is 14, which is really young. And then you've got, you know, the older end. So it's interesting to see them, and we definitely need to, as organizations, be, of course, valuing the generations that are in front of us. But we also believe, you know, if organizations have a 5-year strategic plan, they need to be thinking about this generation now already as the future sort of consumer, or in this context, the future donor. So Soph, what do we know about Gen Z?
Yeah, Gen Z, they are such a fascinating generation. And I've loved, because I've been at McCrindle nearly 7 years, and watching the stats go on Gen Z as they've become a larger cohort of their 18 plus. It's been such an interesting journey to study them and gain insight. But Gen Z are really a global generation looking for global change. They have that view of global citizenship, that they want to see the world in a better place than how they found it, which I think is such an admirable quality for this generation. And as you were saying, that it's so important to understand this emerging donor, because to future-proof your organization, you need to know how to engage with them, whether that's a not-for-profit, whether that's a product, whether that's a service. And when we think about Generation Z, they are in a life stage, I guess, where maybe they don't have quite as much money to be giving. But what they do have is that they have advocacy and influence and agency. And it's really important to not discount that, because they can actually see things shift and change. They can mobilize people, Gen Z, very quickly around a cause. They can bring it to media attention very quickly through social media. They've got a lot of agency to bring change, even if they don't have money. And it's important to engage them now so that then maybe in the years that they do have funds, that your organization is an organization of choice for them to engage with. So if we run through those stats, they, even more so than our Gen Ys, are opportunity givers. So if there is a need presented, that is what they want to be a part of solving. And that's probably linked to their, I guess, level of connectedness to social media, the level of connectedness to knowing what's happening globally, that they want to just, if they see something of need, they want to be part of that solution, which is an incredibly admirable quality. It is challenging for not-for-profits when they're trying to build that base consistent income. So I think for not-for-profits, it's that diversification of income streams is incredibly important for future-proofing your organization. Slight side note to engaging the generations of giving, but an important thing to explore. They are, Gen Z, the most likely generation to be looking to solve that root cause at 84%, that which means that just 16% are actually looking to meet an immediate need. So they're very big picture, wanting to see things shift at a global, at a structural level, which once again is really encouraging, but does pose some challenges on the horizon of how we communicate and how we engage them on that journey to see that long-term change. And then lastly, they are global. So 64% of them want to support organizations working to bring about global change, compared to 36% locally, which if we compare that back to our baby boomers, we had 75% local and just 25% global. So almost the inverse in some ways, which you can see why when we're bringing those comparisons, we're often talking Gen Z and baby boomers, because it is almost an inverse there. So they're the global generation looking for global change. Don't discount them. While they may not have funds, they are giving frequently to a wide range of organizations because they are a socially aware generation that is really mindful of what's happening in the world, and they want to be part of the solution. So I'd say the future is really bright as we think about engaging the generations to the future for bringing about long-term change.
Yeah, absolutely. It's so interesting to like just compare even those extremes, like the Gen Zs to the baby boomers, like you just did. And yeah, I definitely agree. Like, we shouldn't discount the Gen Zs. And I shared this in the event that we ran around, I've heard it said before that at different life stages, you have different amounts of these three things, energy, time, and money. And it could be argued that Gen Z, they probably don't have a lot of money because they may have never had a real, you know, full-time job. They may never even have a part-time job if they're quite on the younger end. But they've got a bit more energy at this life stage and arguably maybe a little bit more time if they don't have families or children. And so how can you motivate or engage them where they're at with their life stage? And if anything, almost, yeah, show your cause to them so that as they get older, they become more of that committed giver, and they, as they get more backing behind them, they become committed to your organization, like you mentioned. But really interesting. And even on the local and global things, I'm reminded of, like you said, so if they're just, they've got more access to information, so they've got that side of things, but they're also more formally educated around causes. But I'm also reminded of the podcast we did a couple of episodes ago with Holly and Luke about getting in the head of Gen Z. And Luke was sharing that he's just grown up as someone who's just seen things around the world, even like, you know, travel and other places around the world. Like, they're often more aware. And sometimes I feel this way myself. Like, I'm more aware of what's going on in global like affairs rather than even what's going on in my local community or local neighborhood or even with my neighbors, because of that like propensity to be engaged with online communities that are digital and global. So it's really, I think, reflected here in these insights that you shared. And again, just to compare, we've got another different top cause among Gen Z, which is mental health. That's the cause this generation is most likely to support, which I probably would have hypothesized that that would have been the case for them, followed by children's charities at number two, and animal welfare and wildlife support and homelessness, actually. So we had two different sort of causes, animal welfare and homelessness, tied there for number three. The number one place they go to stay up to date with charities and not-for-profits is Instagram, followed by emails and Facebook. But I see here, so if you've given a shout out to TikTok as well. So while not in their top three, 43% of Gen Z engage with TikTok at least monthly to stay up to date with charities and not-for-profits. So again, being aware of where your donor base, like where largely what generation comprises your donors and where they are and what their preference is really important. Is that the advice you would have, Soph, around understanding or how these organizations can go about maybe understanding the donors they have in their community and remaining relevant for the future?
Yeah, it's vitally important to take the time to actually understand who your donor base is. And then even, are you missing a whole generation? And maybe then how do you engage them for future proofing? Do you have an aging donor profile? And to future proof your organization, you need to start to experiment with some new ways to engage the next generation. So there's a number of ways that you can do that. It's, you know, we're researchers, so surveys or focus groups with your people. Even just looking at your own email communication that goes out, your social media, if you've got stats, like looking at the stats on that and see what are people engaging with, what's resonating, taking some of this data and insight and overlaying it on your people group and going, oh, does that fit? Are our people consistent with that? Okay, how can we amplify that? Or maybe how should we change tact? And whether it's not-for-profit or any organization, it's, as we started, understanding your people is absolutely vital for serving them well. And that's what we love doing, is helping organizations really have the insights that they need to be able to understand their people, to serve them well, because we really want to empower human flourishing. That's our goal at McCrindle, empowering human flourishing with insights. So that's what we get passionate about. So take the time to understand your people would be my recommendation.
Great insights, great wisdom and recommendations here from you today, Soph. Thank you so much for coming on. Thank you so much for the great work that you do in running and coordinating these huge studies. They're massive. There's a lot of time and energy involved from a lot of people on the team, but shout out to you for your role in that, which is massive. So thank you for your time today.
Thanks, Ash. And as you know, team effort that brings those insights to the to the stage to be shared.
Yes, shout out to all the team members listening in from McCrindle. You know who you are, which is basically everyone. But if people would like to access some of those resources that you mentioned today around the full report or the infographic summary, we have made those available to the general public, and they can be found at mccrindle.com/resources. And if you'd like to stay up to date just in general with our latest insights, you can always subscribe to the podcast. You can follow us on social media or you can head to mccrindle.com. And we've just been doing a little bit of analytics on our podcast lately, and we just wanted to thank all those who are following our podcast. That number's really been growing over the last few months, and it really makes a difference as to how others can discover our podcast and engage with us. So we really appreciate that. This will be our final episode for a couple of weeks as we take a little bit of a break over Easter and the holidays. So feel free to head back through the archives and listen to some of those episodes featuring Soph and Mark and others from our team. And then we look forward to bringing you another season just in a couple of weeks around some really exciting topics that we've got planned. So as always, thank you so much for listening and dropping reviews on this podcast. We really appreciate it. And bye for now.